years ago, and for many years, I kept lists, to-do lists, handwritten. Started probably the late 80s, and every day I'd write out what I need to do on a scrap of paper. And then it became a weekly thing because I got a lot busier. And write, cross things off, carry things over. And there were longer term projects that had to be, I'm just looking at a text here. I don't know what the hell that means. It's kind of the story of my life. I get a text and I go, I don't know what the hell that means. All right. Anyway, now I want to get out of here. Go away. So nowadays, and then, I would type them up on the computer. Didn't like any of the templates that were available, so I would just type up a list, and then every week I would go and carry things over that I didn't get to and delete things that I did, and I had a longer term thing still, even longer term, and so my hand ached less because I was writing less, and nowadays it's a to-do list app, and it's much more efficient. It's a little buggy, but it's the least buggy one I've found, and I've used a bunch. Because I'm pretty serious about my list making. I tell people all the time, hold on, if you're telling me something, hold on, let me write it down. If I don't write it down, if I'm out with my phone, just let me send myself an email. If I don't have it written down, chances are very high I'm not going to remember it. So the thing that kills me is I was going through my list today and it just kept going and going and going. The list keeps growing. That's the thing. It's like some horrible monster from a 50s B movie. It doesn't, no matter what you do. I remember when I was a kid, I had a book. I can't remember what it was called, but it was a Dr. Seuss book. And there were several different stories in it, and one of them was this kid who had to cut the grass on this enormous lawn, and as soon as he cut a piece of grass with the lawnmower, it would just grow up again behind him. So it's just, that's my life. I'm not complaining. I'm just observing and saying it gets a little difficult at times. Could be worse. Could be living in a third world country. No clean water. Judge Collins, I haven't seen this guy in a while. Just had to watch an ad on Twitch before your stream about a KFC chicken sandwich with Cheetos on it. Yeah, I mean, honestly, we were talking about this on the message board last week. We've just become a nation of babies. Like, this is, KFC chicken sandwich with Cheetos on it. This is marketed to adults, right? This is men in shorts outdoors who aren't exercising. It's one thing if you're exercising, just walking around in shorts. The guys show up to church in shorts and flip-flops. Gotta be comfortable. I don't know why. I'll tell you something right now. If you want to look good, if you want to look sharp, I got news for you. Comfort and fashion are diametrically opposed. You can't have both those things. Fashion is uncomfortable. Deal with it. And I'm a pretty unfashionable guy, but I know that. I know that, at least. Oh my gosh. And I don't know which generation. I don't know the difference between a millennial and a Gen Z and a Gen Y. I don't know what they all are. But I'll tell you, man, somebody along the line, one of these generations made adult, the word adult, into a verb. It's just, I was reading a couple weeks ago in Discover Magazine a thing about plate tectonics. I don't know anything about it. That's why I was reading. I was kind of interested in it. And the writer's going blah, 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 like explaining something. And then when it gets sucked back down to Melty Town. Melty Town! And I mentioned that on the message board, and there's a guy on the message board who's a geologist. You know, he works in Sacramento at the university there, or for the state, or both. But he, you know, he's, I don't know if he's a geologist or a seismologist or whatever, but he's out there, you know, he's the last line of defense before the earthquakes. So he knows about plate tectonics. He's just, he's an expert. And he said, yeah, a while back, there was a contest to name this thing, and Melty Town won. I've got nothing to say to that generation, if you're watching. Got nothing to say to you. So, you know, Melty Town, chicken sandwiches with Cheetos on top. And all that, we're just in different worlds, I'm afraid. Scroll up, Tonal Annihilation, good to see you, 5950, right, John M., Kelsey Weasel, good to see you all. Yeah, well, Kelsey Weasel, not only are flip-flops not sexy, I don't want to smell your feet, I don't want to look at your feet! Feet are disgusting. Feet are awful. I couldn't believe it. Years ago, Rex Ryan, when he was coaching the Jets, got found out. Him and his wife had some freaky sex stuff going on websites and stuff. All sorts of disturbing things that I never wanted to learn about Rex Ryan. Foremost, really into feet. Really into feet. Really into, like, had all these YouTube videos of his wife showing off her feet. And he's like the guy behind the camera. I want to see those feet. I want to see anybody. You can show me the most perfect set of feet in the world. I want to see them. Cover them up. That's why God made socks. Well, you know, the reason I'm down here, there's two reasons I'm down here in the bunker instead of up enjoying a cigar. And reason one is it's sweltering hot out. It's not just the heat, it's that Midwest humidity. It just saps the energy out of you. And I'm just in no mood. I've had an extremely busy day. I'm in no mood. The other reason is I was allegedly going to talk to producer Mike Kennerty and Screeching Weasel guitarist Trevor Jackson on Skype, and they were going to join us, and that never happened. I don't know where those guys are, but Trevor was heading straight from London to Oklahoma City. He's got like 3 days off on this tour he's working, and he was going to start some guitar tracking tonight or tomorrow. So I figured, well, you know, let's take half an hour and just check in with these guys and see where things are at and what they're going to work on, but it was not to be. And I still have, I've had on my list for almost a week now that I've got I've just got a couple song notes, you know, no big deal, but a couple song notes I wanted to give to Mike as well. I'll get around to that at some point. Oh, there he is right there. That was that ding. Here. They left to get food. No, those would drive me crazy. And I know, you know, people get hungry. People have to eat. I get that. But it would always drive me crazy, especially in your studio. Like, you know, or you're on the road. There's always the one guy's like, I'm hungry. Like, always said in this way, like, I'm going to die. Terrible things are going to happen if we don't take a break in the studio right now and get food, or if we don't pull over at the nearest Wendy's and get food. It's like, you know, grow up, man. Like, buy yourself a few granola bars to stash in your pockets you know, to tide you over until the rest, you know, until the grown-ups decide it's time to take a break to eat. Just unbelievable. Anyway, I can't see if I sent that. Yeah, I can still Skype you in, I said. So let's see. So Skype is muted. I think the problem before that I was dealing with is that I didn't Skype mute the Skype. Sorry. Be that as it may. Okay, so blah, blah, blah. Somebody called me a boomer. Nah, I'm too young for that. Yeah. Tonal Annihilation. The UK voted to name a ship Bodie McBoatface. Oh, that's fucking adorable, isn't it? Oh, it's so funny. Been watching World Cup soccer with your kid. You know, I was watching with my daughter, and she's real into softball right now, cause soccer ended. And I didn't, you know, it's just, we gotta get political. Just stop. I don't want to turn the TV on anymore. Like, you turn it on to watch soccer and somebody's got to use their platform. You know, I have a platform because you're good at something that has nothing to do with politics. That's what you're supposed to use your platform for. For more of that. That's what people want. And it just started to get, you know, oh, I'm going to do this during the national anthem. I don't even know what the hell they were doing. You know, I watch sports to get away from that. Don't care about you and your fucking platform. Kick the fucking ball, dum-dum. Yeah, Kelsey, so that guy was a troll. Oh, yeah, he told me to die. I mean, eventually, we will all shuffle off this mortal coil into the great unknown. And I hope that in the afterlife, me and Trolley McTrollface, as Tonal Annihilation said, will be together in the light of the Almighty. I mean that sincerely. He's not off to a good start! You know what? I wasn't either for most of my life. So what's up? What are you guys up to? I'm just seeing if these rascals are ever going to be on Skype and. All right. This is just another thing that didn't work out. I think I'm gonna have to take that attitude. This is just another thing that didn't work out, and it's not a big deal. It's not a big deal, really. And you know, if I Skype these guys in live, there's going to be like 19 fuck-ups. Yeah, there's water running. I'm right near the water pipe. Somebody's taking a shower. That's what you're hearing. The household sounds. Have you guys ever heard, what is it called? I got to look it up now. It's like the Strauss tone poem, Symphonia Domestica, something like that. I'm going to look it up. Anyway, but part of the reason that gave me a push, I think, to really, Symphonia Domestica Opus 53, tone poem for a large orchestra by Richard Strauss, says Wikipedia. But part of the reason I got into it was I was reading the Barbara Tuchman book, The Proud Tower. This was some years ago. And it's about... It's basically about the, my recollection is probably about the 10 to 15 years before the First World War, kind of what life was like in the West. And there's a whole chapter on the emergence of Strauss and how shocking people found his music. And I mean, it's primarily about Strauss. But she goes into great detail about this tone poem, which people were outraged by for various and sundry reasons, including at one point he writes something that is supposed to approximate he and his wife having sex. So it kind of like starts out, everybody's running around the house, the kids are going nuts, they're at the breakfast table. At some point they take a break to make love to each other, as husbands and wives do. And this is immortalized in the tone poem. So you're getting a little Symphonia Domestica there, a little ambient sound. You might have heard the toilet flush earlier too. I gotta find this thing. The family went camping. I don't camp. I'm not a camper. I don't sleep out of doors, for one thing. But so they went camping. It's not that far away, so I drove up there on some day last week, and spent the afternoon hanging out. I took the kids out on the lake in a canoe. God help me. We're all wearing life vests. I mean, this lake, it I imagine it has to be man-made because there's tree stumps. All it's like, if you fell in, you would have to work really hard to drown because it would like go up to mid-shin. You know, your paddle's hitting the bottom while you're canoeing, but it was just god awful. I mean, you know, if you're a little bit of a clean freak like me, and I don't think of myself as being overly uptight in that department, but you know, it's all relative. And you go to a campground, first of all, public toilets right there. I mean, no. So and then secondly, you know, you go you gotta get the key, you gotta unlock the chain on the canoe and turn it over and get it in the water and so forth, and you're out there, you know, paddling around like a fool. And okay, well, you know, it's nice out. It's a little hot, but it wasn't buggy, surprisingly. Except, it turns out, in the canoe. Because we're out there for about 20 minutes, and suddenly the inchworms start crawling down the inside of this thing. And all the kids, you know, I'm up on a beam, but all the kids are sitting down. And I don't want to alarm them, because then somebody starts freaking out, and the thing capsizes, and somebody makes a sitcom scene out of it. But then ants are crawling. You know, my God. Paddle back to the shore. Get the canoe turned over and chained up again. And, you know, just filthy lake water on my hands. There's inchworms probably crawling all over my body. It's just, you know, I get back to the campsite, just give me some Purell, you know, I wanted to just fill a bathtub with it and soak in it for a week. So it's just, it was just awful. And the night before, you know, they had slept at the campsite in a tent, and there had been a terrible thunderstorm, like half the night. I mean, they were up half the night. It's just terrible. It was real humid and just blech, blech. So I was home alone during that time, a couple days, and instead of, you know, catching up on more, well, I caught up on a little bit of reading and a movie that I've been watching in shifts for like 2 weeks. You know, like a 90-minute movie that takes forever to watch. But I started watching these old videos of the kids. I guess I missed my family. And I found one that just, I can't find it again. I mean, it's on there somewhere, but it's, we had the band, it's like a band party up here at the house, and my daughter at the time, who must have been five, maybe six, probably more like five, I had watched Frankenstein Meets the Wolfman with her not long before that, and she proceeded to tell the guys in the band all about the movie, and it's about the funniest, I don't know, 3.5 minutes I've ever, I mean, it's not so much as fun, it's just adorable, and I don't, you know, I realize that most people wouldn't find it as amusing as I do because it is my daughter after all, but the kid's got a lot of character, or is a character, at least. Something, I'm just going up here, the Queers played, place, it was a great show. They played a couple Weasel songs. Right, John M. I can't imagine telling my wife and kids they were going camping without me. How do you get away with that? I wear the pants in the house. I'm not running around outdoors. See, this is the thing, right, John M. I'm not running around outdoors with shorts on. I actually did at the campground. I wore shorts outside, and I wasn't exercising. But now, I don't wear shorts. I don't say things like Bodie McBoatface, you know? I mean, just not doing that makes you so much more masculine than everybody else that right there. I mean, it sets a tone. It sets a tone. So, you know. I think the real answer is nobody really gives a damn if I don't go. All right. There's another thing here. Oh, they're still out. They're still out. That's why we can't Skype. So they're going to start streaming tomorrow, he says. So I think, okay, I can get out of here. I think Trevor must be just taking the night to readjust to the new time zone and then presumably he'll be up bright and early. So, plan for the next couple days, 2-3 days, there will be some streaming. There will not be audio. So, you know. No, Judge Collins has asked me, what is our temperature at which it is acceptable to wear shorts? I mean, out in public, like going somewhere? No, I don't. I mean, I guess, you know, 130? I don't know. I mean, you know, to me, it's just not, it's a kid thing. You know, my son wears shorts. That's fine. He's a boy. But I guess I wear them on the golf course. I haven't been golfing in years. Every summer, oh, I got to get out there. And then I go, well, I can't just get out there. I haven't played in so long. I got to get out to the driving range. Get out to the putting green, practice a little bit, practice especially those chip shots. And I just never find the time. So no, and then he wants to ask about socks with low-cut shoes. I don't know, man. I don't know. I mean, it's not really, if you're not wearing shorts, it doesn't matter, does it? It's irrelevant. Because your socks are covered up. Right, John M. is going golfing tomorrow in shorts. I think that's okay. I think it's okay because it may not be exercise per se, but you are engaging in a sport, you know. So I think that's fine. I have no problem with, know, shorts on the golf course. I'm talking about literally, you know, going to church in a fucking pair of shorts. That's fucking bullshit. You know, going to a restaurant, okay, that doesn't have Mick in front of the name, in shorts. No, come on. You know, if you're older than 12, no. So I had the camping adventure. It wasn't much of an adventure, but I believe it was last week. We had somebody in the chat who was talking about, I think she said she was from Arizona, and she was talking about, I was talking about biking, and she was saying that she bikes and typically does 30 miles. And I'm like, you know, I've heard that before from people. Oh, yeah, 30 miles. Like, you know, I take that as a personal challenge. I don't know why. Something about my personality went out and did what I approximated to be about 30 miles. I mean, you know, if you're gonna kind of keep moving and end up where you started, you got to guesstimate it. But, and so it was just under 27 miles. It took me about an hour 35. That was Saturday. And my legs still hurt. It's Monday. My legs still, I haven't worked out since then. I like crouched down, you know, to pick something up. And my knees, you know, I mean, this is no, you know, no real impact, but. And I hit this point where there's a point on the trail going out, and it's kind of, it's very close to the halfway point. And there's some, you know, there are some hills. I mean, you know, I live in a fairly hilly area, but, and they suck, especially if the wind's going against you, but they're not brutal. But this one, you don't see it coming, man. You don't see it coming, and you don't really see it, but it goes up. And the problem, I think, is that it goes up. It doesn't seem steep, but it's relentless. It just keeps going up and up and up. And then you finally plateau, and there's this last little bit that's really steep. And now I've done that section before. And every time I end up just, I gear down, you know, way down. I'm down. Well, I've got three gears of nine each. I'm always on the top one. So I gear down to like one or two. And I'm just, one of these is right through this really wealthy, it's a bike path, but you're like going next to the backyards of these fucking mansions. And, I swear that's where they're going to find me dead, you know? Like some rich cocksucker's gardener is going to find me splayed out on the bike path wearing bike shorts. The indignity. I tend to push myself too hard with that kind of thing, which was not a problem when I was younger. Getting older, I think you got to learn to pace yourself. And I don't seem to be able to learn how to do that. And I'm probably going to go do it again tomorrow if it's not raining. We've been getting a lot of rain and a lot of threats of rain. I have found since I moved to Wisconsin, I don't know, 13 years ago, the forecasts are unbelievable. Like, we are constantly being forecast for rain that we never get. It's the strangest thing, right? You know, what, 140 miles, if that, from where I grew up. And it's just the there's constant rain in the forecast, it seems. And, like, it shows up just a fraction of that time. Right, John M. says, there's a thing called glamping now. Yeah, I read about that a few years ago. Air-conditioned cabins and less manual labor. Well, they have little cabins up there at that particular campsite, and some people will drive up with their campers and stuff, but it's still, it's so dirty. It's so dirty. It's just dirty and buggy and hot. You know, I came home from that and I walked into the house and it was the AC and I was like, oh, fuck. And I had stopped at my mailbox on the way home, got my mail. And next door to the where my mailbox is, there's a Starbucks. I got myself an Americano, and I just down on the couch, and drank my coffee, read my book, you know, and just appreciated being indoors, you know, in the house that I worked so hard to be able to buy. Instead of being out with the dirt and the smells and the bugs and the public toilets. Ugh. Yeah, right, John M. says, you do come home from camping feeling like a wet sock. Dude, I was there for an afternoon, and I came home feeling like I've just got to wash the grime off me. You know? Because I didn't go straight to reading the book and drinking the coffee. I waited on the car. I actually went straight to the shower. Oh, pitcher for the Angels died in Texas today. The Angels were playing, I think it was Houston. I think the game has been canceled or postponed. I'm not familiar with this pitcher. I haven't followed baseball in general very closely for years now. But a guy died in his hotel room. They were playing the Rangers? Well, why was he in a hotel in Houston then? Thought it said Houston. Molf has been biking a lot lately. Try and ride 3 or 4 times a week. Yeah, I try to get out 5, 6 times a week, but it depends on my schedule and it depends on whether, you know, if it's a little light rain, I'll go out, but I'm not going to go out in a thunderstorm. So, Trevor's going to be tracking guitars. No, his name wasn't Glasser. I don't remember his name. I probably got it on the phone. Hang on. I don't think it was Glasser. That doesn't sound familiar. Hang on, I'll find it. Sit tight. Because, you know, you don't have the internet or anything. I'm like a fucking sorcerer here. Tyler Skaggs. He's a young guy, too. It's like, I think he was in his early 20s. I need to get a bike rack. Our new neighborhood has nowhere to ride. You mean to transport your bike to a place where you go? I mean, one of the great things about Madison, I mean, there are just miles upon miles upon miles of trails, and they do a very good job, all things considered, of connecting them. Now, there's, on the route that I've been doing lately, there is, I start out on one trail, I move to a second trail and do the entirety of that trail. It's not a particularly long one, but I start, you know, I start and end on that trail. And then you have to ride on a fairly busy road with like a 35 mile, and it's like 30 or 35 mile an hour speed limit. And you got to go like a mile or so up that to connect to the other trail. And that's a little hair. I just don't like doing it. I don't like riding on the road. I don't trust people. But like from my house to the beginning of the trail, it's about a mile and a half. But I can do it on real quiet side streets and like about probably about a fourth of it actually is a bike path. Before you get to the bike path proper. And so I can do, you know, I'll do like 25 miles, and almost all of that is on the trail. And I do, there are some places where I have to stop for like cross streets, but relatively few. You can really, and it's beautiful, you know. The path I've been taking goes right on the, on the south end of the Arboretum. The path actually crosses over the belt line at one point. Some nice wooded areas. It's really beautiful. I see nature like you wouldn't believe. Last week, before that Saturday ride that almost killed me, I was out, I saw a deer right there on the path. You know, there's a guy half a furlong in front of me, and the deer saw us two coming and took off, obviously, as deers are wont to do. But chipmunks galore, frogs, geese all over the place, turkeys, very common to see turkeys. The sandhill cranes are, it's seldom that I go out for a ride of any length and don't see some sandhill cranes. Always in pairs. So last week, a pair, male, female, with a baby sandhill crane. Technodron 3 says, greetings from Albany, New York. The city has made massive improvements in bike lanes and upkeep and trails along the Hudson. It's perfect. Yeah, but you're in Albany, New York. I mean, I'm in Madison. That's bad enough. Albany, New York, you get like 2 months a year you can actually use those paths. I mean, here, you know, I don't mind that much going out in the cold as long as it's not too windy. So I'll start sometimes in March, you know, usually April. And then I can go to, you know, like through, depending on how cold it's getting through, you know, early November. It's a pretty good chunk of the year. What I'd like to do, I can't afford it, but what I'd like to do is get one of those trainers where you take your rear wheel off, you hook your chain up to the thing, and then you get, you know, I don't know if it's like the Pelotron, is that what it's called? I don't know if it's a thing where you got to do a subscription, but there are different software packages you can get where you're, you know, kind of, you're looking on the screen and you're going, you know, you hook it up to your monitor and TV, whatever, and, you know, you're going, like, you're riding up Mount Everest. Not that I would ever do that. You know, the entry level one of those is $600, and then you've still got to, you know, you've still got to get the software. So that's probably not going to happen. But I think I'm going to do what we talked about a while back. You know, somebody, I can't remember who it was, but thank you again, because somebody had mentioned that Planet Fitness does like a $10 membership. You can't, you know, I don't know, you don't get locker room privileges or something. Who cares? I'm going to shower nude in a locker room with, I was a member of the gym up at the, what they call the Shell, part of UW here. And I wanted to be there because they've got an 8th mile track, an indoor track. I like running, and I ended up quitting that gym because I got an injury, and I think it was an injury from running on that short of a track. Like quarter mile track, I'm okay, but that 8th mile, even, you know, changing directions, they make you change direction every day. It's still, I got this ankle thing. I was hobbling around for weeks and couldn't work out. But the thing that drove me nuts, and it's true, you know, it's like a stand-up comedy, you know, cliche, but it's really true that you go into these locker rooms and it's always the old guys way too comfortable with their bodies, full on naked, like, you know, one leg up on the bench, having conversations. Come on, man. Have some shame. That was gross. That was very gross. There, I just couldn't get into in and out of that locker room, and by God, I moved fast. I couldn't get in and out of there without seeing one repulsive old naked guy who, you know, you can't help how you look, but when you're basically flaunting it and daring people to look at you, then fuck you. Fucking old prick. You can't grunt out loud at Planet Fitness, says Right John M. They escort you out if you make noises. Well, I just do cardio. I mean, I breathe heavy. Is that gonna cause a problem? But I'm not gonna do weights over there. So, I'm trying to think of what the heck I've done in the past week besides riding my bike and day camping. I'm a day camper. They had these things. I took some pictures. I even took a video. So right the entrance where, you know, there's, I mean, it's not like super heavy traffic, but there's cars coming in and out. I had never seen this before. If I had, I forgot. I probably did see it when I was a kid. But little tiny frogs, like, literally about as big as a man's fingernail, hopping around like crazy. And the only place I saw them was in that, and there were just dozens upon dozens of them, right where people are driving in and out. I think, you know, they've got to be getting killed left and right. Anyway, what are those? I mean, they're frogs, but they're clearly not just like baby frogs. I wouldn't think. You know, they're like midget frogs. I don't know what they are. If anybody knows what they are, tell me, because they were freaking me out. And they can tell you're, you know, I had the camera, and I'm just walking behind one, and he's just taking off. He's, oh my gosh, he's just hopping away like mad. You'd think they wouldn't be in a high traffic area. I do like canoeing, actually. I would have preferred a river, you know, where you can go. If you get a basic idea, like, okay, you get into your canoe, go down the river, and then, you know, like, whatever, it twists around to where, basically so you can't get lost. So I remember going camping summer before eighth grade. I don't know how or why, but there was a summer camping trip that certain individuals were able to go to. I don't know what the criteria was, but I ended up on this camping trip. It was for like a week or, I don't know, maybe 2 weeks. I don't really remember. But at one point we did a very long, as I recall, canoeing trip, you know, like an afternoon. It was very enjoyable. Just went on and on and on and on. Relaxing. Right, John M. says, my wife made corn muffins for our last camping trip. A raccoon stole them. You sound like a first grader who was asked to write an essay. Right, John M. The fuck? Tonal Annihilation says there's a guy in Australia who kills cane toads by driving over them in his van. I'm sure there is. I mean, you just said that, right? You don't know this for a fact. It's just, there's got to be, right? Kelsey Weasel, have you thought any more about doing an e-newsletter? Yeah, I sure have, Kelsey Weasel. Thought about it. I don't know, Kelsey Weasel, how to make things come to fruition in this brave new world. I just don't. I don't. So I hit up Tom, the agent, and he said, yes, we do have a mailing list, but it's much smaller than you would think because most of the time the promoters won't share people's email addresses with us. I mean, we always get permission, but they just don't want to do it. So apparently the mailing list isn't too big, but I don't really care about that because we can grow the mailing list over time. But, you know, this is all, what I would really like is to be able to get to the point where I don't need to be on social media at all, ever. I never need to go to Facebook. I never need to go to Twitter, Instagram. I just don't go. And anything, any communication I do is done in that old-fashioned way. I realize, and I, you know, I just, everything is just so much more hassle than it ought to be. It's not the work. Like, the work is such a small percentage. Like, writing an e-newsletter, that's like, I mean, that's enjoyable. That takes no time. That's really no skin off my back at all. It really isn't. But all the other stuff where it's like, oh, now I need this, now I need that. Oh, we got to do this, and we got to coordinate that, and fucking all that bullshit. First of all, I don't want to do it. And second of all, I'm no good at it. And third of all, like, even when it gets done, it's just, it you realize, like, man, I put all this effort into it, and it just, the tree bears no fruit, or very little. You know, it's not like, I think a big part of the problem, Kelsey Weasel, and anybody else who's paying attention, is if the internet has changed our brains. We don't have any attention span anymore. There's not, like, yeah, I follow this guy on Twitter, and that's cool, but it's just another voice among so many, and they become indistinct. Judge Collins is having problems with slugs. I'm sorry to hear that. I've been having problems with them for years, but mine are metaphorical, and play guitars. Do you think the next generation will even use social media? Our generation is ruined already. I mean, whatever, you know, yes, in the sense that that's how we're going to continue to connect, unfortunately, but, you know, there's always a backlash. I mean, every once in a while you read an article about somebody who's like completely dropped their smartphone and, you know, gone old school and all that. And honestly, I don't want to do that. I like being able to pick up the phone and, you know, see the weather forecast. I don't think that's the problem. I really don't. I like being able to be in touch with my family via text. You know, I don't miss the bad old days in that regard. But what I do miss is the way what I don't like is how much worse, it was already bad, but how much worse things have become in terms of mob behavior and really just in general, how we treat each other and how we express ourselves. But there's no question in my mind, and we're already pretty dumb to start with as a people, but we have become increasingly stupid. Every year we get dumber and dumber, and you think the bar can't go any lower, and it just keeps going down. We are very, very, very stupid, shallow, superficial people. I think that's been true for a very long time, but the internet has made that much worse. Technodron says, I feel as though your voice would, as it has when I first listened to the band 15 years ago, captivate those who don't have the attention span of fruit flies. Yeah, but that's, I mean, I'm including myself in that. I think that's all of us. I think all of us have lost our attention span. And I you know, maybe not as bad because I do have an attention span for, you know, for for things like, you know, longer movies. If I can't sit down and watch a long movie in a sitting, it's not because I don't have the attention span. It's because I don't have the time, or because I'm falling asleep. Because, you know, it's 9 o'clock at night. But I include myself in that. I mean, I've got no patience for, especially like for rock music. I've got no patience for people are like, oh, check out this band. It's like fucking, you know, 15 seconds. I'm sorry. It didn't blow me away. Fuck you. And that's a shitty attitude to have. I know it. And I don't like it when people have that attitude with my music, but it's like, just click the button. I don't even got to get up and hit stop like I used to. You know, you used to, you'd be like, yeah, I'm kind of lazy. I don't like this, but I'm just going to let it play at least for a minute. Let me finish my cigarette. I'll get up and turn it off. Nope, just psh, turn it off. So, it's not me versus the world. It's me versus me. And all of you. None of us have that attention span anymore. But I do think, I was saying earlier about these people, you'll read these articles about people, oh, they're dropping the cell phone or what, and I don't want to do that. But I do think there will be a major backlash, and it will come from younger people. I think you've seen it to an extent already. I think the cassette phenomena, if it's not really big enough to be called a phenomena, but I think that's a sign of that. Of people wanting to go to something slower, and maybe that will continue, and then I'll find something new to be annoyed with. All these people who want to go back to the olden days, because I mean, it's the cell phone and the smartphone have undoubtedly changed life for the better. It's really two things that have made things worse, and they're very connected. And that's social media and the way we consume news, which is basically exactly the way we used to consume entertainment. So we've taken everything about that experience of consuming entertainment and just put that onto news. It's the same thing. It's the same thing. People are passionate about their politics the same way they used to be passionate about, you know, rock and roll versus disco or whatever. And it's a different kind of passion that you used to find, I think, that you used to find among people who are politically minded, for the most part. Basically, what happened was the crazies became mainstream. So, you know, in the old days over, you know, Maximum Rock and Roll and stuff like that, like, yeah, people were fucking nuts about politics. But they were in the minority. That was not a mainstream attitude at all. That is a mainstream attitude now. And, you know, like the shit we saw the other day in Portland. I mean, I don't know what's become of our country when you can say, well, he's a right winger, so fuck him. After a bunch of white guys wearing masks, gee, that sounds kind of familiar. Were they white robes with pointy hoods? No, but kind of the same thing. Attack a gay Asian man, beat him up. But it's okay because he's a right winger. He was inciting violence. Got to put that in air quotes because, of course, he wasn't actually inciting violence, but you extrapolate that when you say the personal is political, you justify anything. Yeah, but you know he supports things that are way worse than anything we could do to him. So we have a duty to physically attack the guy. And that's the kind of lunacy and what does the mayor do out there? Not a fucking thing, except tell the cops to stand down. You know. Well, you know, we get the politicians we deserve. I believe that. And I believe that whatever you think about Donald Trump, this is not a political statement. I promise you. This is a statement about our culture. Okay? But I believe, and I'm speaking not from a policy perspective, give a fuck about that. I'm talking about the kind of person, kind of president, the kind of public persona that Donald Trump is. It's a miracle that it took as long as it did for America to get a president like Donald Trump. It's a miracle. Because the science fiction writers were writing about that stuff back in the 50s and 60s. I'm surprised it didn't happen in the early 80s. People kind of saw Reagan like that because he had been an actor. And that was, if you can believe it at the time, that was kind of like, oh my God, come on, an actor? An actor can't be, you know, a Hollywood movie actor, he can't be president. You know, how naive were we? And so now we've got a reality TV guy who's president. And this is, you know, we're living in a reality TV world. We got exactly what we deserved. We got exactly what we had coming to us. I don't want to bastardize the quote because I don't remember it exactly, but it's something along the lines of democracy is the idea that people know what they want and they deserve to get it good and hard. H.L. Mencken, I believe, said that. Of course, we can't listen to H.L. Mencken anymore. We really shouldn't quote him anymore because it turned out he was a secret racist. Found his racist diaries. And we've got to cancel everybody from the past who thought bad thoughts. Mm. Telling you, man, we're living in 1984. So, I have no idea how to operate in this world. None whatsoever. None. That's a very long answer to your question, Kelsey Weasel. Yes, I am, but it's like a voice crying out in the wilderness. I don't know. I can write the damn thing. I don't know what good it's going to do. And it always helps to have people like, fuck, yeah, great idea. Let me take the ball and run with it. And I don't have that right now. And I've got too much on my plate to make that happen. So eventually I'll do it. Just like eventually I got around to doing this live stream. But look at where we're at, man. We got 20 people, which I think is probably the most we've ever had live on here. I don't have a lot of viewers here, you know. And you can make the argument, and you'd be absolutely right, that I don't do a very good job of promoting it. But also, I've tried to promote it, and I've seen the results, and they are not impressive. It kind of makes you go, yeah, I don't think this promotion thing is really, you know, how much more time you want to spend throwing things at the wall to see if they stick? Yeah, Judge Collins, he was Asian and gay. So a bunch of white guys in masks beating up a gay minority. And that is totally not only acceptable, but laudable. And if you look, I've seen an awful lot on Twitter of the left-wing press, it's basically like, oh, come on, this guy is loving the attention. You'd think, like, maybe one of them would pop up and go, that's fucked up! That's fucked up! You can't do that! It's acceptable. You know, the guy ended up in the hospital with brain bleed. Posted photos. He's got cuts all over his face. They got, like, his earlobe was separated. Like, the bottom of the earlobe was separated from his fucking head. And I have known those exact people. You know, not literally those people, but their prototypes. Scum. Always were scum, self-centered, fucking delusional, treated everybody around them like shit. You know, you see the one guy at the end of the video attacking him from the guy's already, he's been pepper sprayed, he's fucking, like, walking away and comes in and fucking clocks him from behind. It reminded me so much of seeing the Nazi skinheads at shows. At punk shows in the 80s. Exactly the same. All they're missing is the swastika. Exactly the same. But no. We're the anti-fascists. Fuck you. You're fucking fascists. And eventually, most of them, I have to think, will wake up one day and go, holy fuck, I was exactly what I claimed to be against. And I hope that happens. You know, that can be a moment of great personal growth. But people like that are always going to exist. The real scum, in my opinion, are the people who enable them, the people who pat them on the back. Like, they're already cowards because they won't fight anybody except in a group, just like the Nazi skinheads. Wouldn't fight anybody except in a group. So they're already cowards, but then you get the people who back them up who are even more cowardly because they won't even get out there with the gang. They're too scared to even do that. You know. Absolutely repulsive. You know. I'm not going to play Georgia. I'm not going to make a movie in Georgia because of the fucking, you know, wasn't everybody boycotting South Carolina or North Carolina at some point over some fucking bathroom thing? And now nobody's going to be in Georgia because of their fucking abortion law, which is stupid as hell for a variety of reasons, not the least of which is anybody with a fucking brain in their head knows the Supreme Court is going to knock that shit down. Everybody knows it, except for the absolute marks. You know, and I guess that's a lot of people and a lot of people on Twitter. But you know, if I were going to pick a place, like, don't play there again, it would be Portland. Not on principle, just on, like, I don't want to be. We missed last time we were in Portland. We missed by less than half a day getting trapped around one of these fucking things. You know, because they shut everything down because fuck normal people, right? Fuck the people who we claim to be helping. Like, we're for minorities. We're for homosexuals. Except when we're beating the shit out of them for having the wrong opinions. Honestly. And it's nothing new. That's punk rock going back a long time, but it's mainstream now. No, somebody's asking about a Ramones thing that I've never heard of and haven't. No, I have not listened. I haven't listened to it. I'm not even aware of it. This is the first I've heard of it. I'm not big on that stuff. Like, really going all out to, you know, unearth every little thing that a band did. Just not my kind of. You know, I find overwhelmingly when you hear, like, here's these demos that nobody's ever heard before. You know, the Scorpions, when they were demoing for Blackout, here's these songs that, because they're not very good. That's why they didn't make them on the album, you know? So, 7:36, been going for a while. I got to take a whiz. I actually have to get back to work, which I hate doing at night. I work at night now. I get wired and I can't sleep. And I end up too late. Oh my God. And last night, got to sleep at a reasonable hour. I woke up at 12:20, had been dreaming a song. Like, oh man, this fucking song is good. And this never happened to me actually, but from the time that I got up and came down here with the guitar, I had forgotten exactly how it went. I remembered the melody, but I didn't remember the chord progression behind it. And so I just kind of, you know, had to fake it. And I haven't listened to it since I did it, but I don't think it's very good. I mean, it's okay. It could even be good, but it's not like it was in my dream where it was fucking great. And I was, like, literally in the dream singing the song, going, thinking in the dream, this is fucking awesome. And here's this chord change that's a fucking curveball and nobody's expecting it and it kicks ass. Oh, and here I'm going up an octave on the vocal, and then I'm changing up the melody a little bit. Like, it was all happening in real time, and it was good. And I hate when I lose those, and I usually don't. I usually just, it keeps going through my head until I can get it down on the voice memo. But anyway, enjoyed visiting with you all tonight. Hello, LaChoy Boy from Norway. And keep in mind, we're going to be live streaming some guitar tracking. No, there will not be audio. So what is the reason? What is the compelling reason to come to the live stream and watch? I don't know. The same. All I can say, it's the same thing as the Eagle Nest Cam. Okay? Google Eagle Nest Cam. Same thing. Watch it or don't. I don't care. I'm not going to make any money either way. But we're recording a new album and we're live streaming some of the video of the actual recording. If that sort of thing interests you, make sure your notifications are turned on your smartphone or your tablet or what have you. And you'll get a notice when we go live and you can watch it. Or not. Thank you so much for joining me. You can subscribe, as always, to this stream. If you have Amazon Prime, you can link your account with Twitch Prime and you will get one free subscription per month. Why not make it this channel? You can also cheer me with bits if you like, which people do sometimes. Good to see some of the people we haven't seen in a while, like Judge Collins, some of the new people like Technodron 3. Oh, there's Not Much Fun Jen. She was the bike rider. Okay, so if you want to go back and watch the archive, you can. I mentioned you because I tried to do a 30-mile ride and almost died. Thank you so much for being here. I will see you next week. Until then, keep your eyeballs peeled for the live streaming of the record. And so long. Oh, and have a great 4th of July this Thursday.